Coming to you from Rochester, Minnesota. This that waking up at noon at the window. Our town. You doing whatever we choose
on
the roof, singing
nothing gonna hold me back. On July 7th of this year, the Olmsted County Board of Commissioners voted to expand a program which teams up community outreach workers with local law enforcement. A new role was created as a result of this expansion, and today we have the pleasure of welcoming Nikki Niles, the new program manager for the Diversity, Equity, and Community Outreach Team at the county. Welcome to our town, Nikki.
Thank you. Thank you for having me.
Well, congratulations on this role. And to get us started, why don't you talk to us a little bit about what your vision is for this newly formed Diversity, Equity, and Community Outreach Team?
Absolutely. So my vision for the new formed team is really to provide services and education that set the bar and meet expectations of addressing diversity and equity for members of our community. This team is comprised of three different units under the umbrella of the outreach, community outreach program. That being pretrial services, the outreach specialists, and eventually the children of incarcerated parents. And then within all of these units of this team are populations that are really disproportionately affected and disparately represented, right? When we think about our folks in jail, some of the calls for service that we get, we really see those disproportionate and disparate numbers represented in that. And all three branches, if you will, of this team are reflective then of that, right? We are the ones that will supervise those folks in our community. So I envision being able to use the resources within our community that address the needs in an effort to make obtaining services equitable and fair across the board for our men and women in our community.
For sure, that's quite a charge. And you mentioned those disparities that we know exist, the disproportionate number of people of color, certainly, and low-income people that have to be part of the system and use the services. In what ways will your role work to address and eliminate these disparities in the different types of county community services?
Absolutely. Well, I think, you know, when we respond to these calls, right, and if we, with having these social workers in place, are responding to these calls that are exclusive to those needs, right? So members of our community that have mental health, chemical health, homelessness, poverty, when we respond to those without maybe this kind of catch-all, and I don't mean catch-all in a bad way, but prior to this being onboarded 3 years ago, the men and women in uniform were the ones exclusively responsible for addressing these needs. Now that we're taking the time to kind of shift that, right, and let our men and women in uniform focus on the crime that's happening, and allow our social workers and our therapists, our professionals that are trained in that aspect to respond to these calls for service, I think that alone helps to limit and address the disparity that we see as residual from those men and women that are then in our correctional system. But it's not just us either that can do this work, right? This work has to occur across all systems within our county, right? All systems within our law enforcement system, our judicial system, our correctional system, and now this system to help really lower and address those needs. So I think that's where this team will excel at doing that, but it really takes work across multi-systems to be able to meet those needs and really truly address disparity and start to see those things being then reflected from the services that we provide.
For sure, you're sort of painting this really integrated ecosystem that's necessary to eliminate these disparities. And I know, especially in the climate that we're in with the renewed struggle for Black lives and just all the conversations around law enforcement, you know, there was that conversation and there have been those moments of saying, well, you know, what should and shouldn't law enforcement be doing? And so to your point, this really sort of great way of saying, actually, let's have law enforcement focus on the criminal sort of system and all these other professionals that can really help do all the other types of wraparound services and things that are needed. So you, of course, are no stranger to work in advocacy and social justice in the community and the county. How do you see your previous work, especially in law enforcement and certainly outside of that, contributing to your new role?
Right, yeah. So, you know, previously I was a police officer for 10 years in the state of Michigan. And so I really see my training and experience in that role playing a vital part in this, because I can understand and I relate to what the men and women in uniform are going through here in our community. And often in law enforcement, when you're called for a call for service, you have to quickly and sometimes hastily make a decision. It's not like when I get called to a call, well, I can spend my entire shift on that one particular call. So when we think about, you know, the time, if you will, that officers have to respond to call, and then in certain communities not even having adequate resources to respond to that, that's sometimes how we get the outcomes that we do. And so I understand ultimately, right, the objective is the same. Even though law enforcement has their role, we have our role, at the end of the day, the objective is about the member of the community and giving that person the best outcomes possible. But we all explicitly have a specific role to meet then that end goal. So we're fortunate within our community to have these services and these resources that can address these needs. And so let's do that. Let's use our evidence-based practices and what science and research tells us, what other models in the country that have been doing this program for a while have shown, to utilize it and put our own kind of Minnesota, Rochester area flair on it, to, again, just give our community members their best outcomes possible.
Wonderful. Well, thank you so much, Nikki, for joining us. I'm sure we'll have you back on as your role develops and new initiatives come out of this wonderful team that you're going to be leading. Thanks a lot.
Thank you, Nicole. I'd love to come back anytime.
Our Town is brought to you in part by the following amazing people and organizations:
the Minnesota Arts and Cultural Heritage Fund and the citizens of Minnesota,
and the members of KSMQ Public Television. Thank you.
Be sure to stick around. We have more great stories coming your way next. We check out the new Shahnoor Shafqat exhibit at the Rochester Art Center, and we hear about the latest findings of the Intercultural Cities Index report. But up first, we dress the Abbey at the Chateau Theater in this week's Art Culture segment.
These exhibitions, besides being very hands-off, they are very, what do I say, pleasing to men, women, children, and then all sorts of cultural institutions, from art museums to cultural centers to history museums. And so that's really kind of the impetus behind doing costume exhibitions. Hi, I'm Amy Noble-Seitz. I'm the CEO of Exhibits Development Group, and I'm the Grand Ambassador of the Chateau Theater on Peace Plaza in Rochester, Minnesota. The Chateau was purchased by the City of Rochester and went through a renovation. And last fall, Exhibits Development Group was selected to operate it for the next 5+ years. First of all, we were really thankful that Mayo Clinic, when they learned that we did the original Downton Abbey costume tour back in 2015 through 18, when we told them that we could obtain the costumes again, they supported us. So we got a hold of those very quickly last year in 2019. And we intended on having them in Rochester for only 8 weeks. The exhibition should be in New York City right now, but due to the quarantine regulations, we're not able to travel it yet. The exhibition will be at the Chateau Theater through September, and then we hope to bring it to New York where it's supposed to be. Our partner in London, who makes those beautiful costumes, is the award-winning costumier in the costume house that's developed by John Bright. It's called Cosprop. The visitor also can get up really close and look at those costumes and see really how fashion changes when you can get so close to it. That's made for theater, for film, and for Broadway. You can see the old textiles they use, the hand beading, particularly with the Downton Abbey fame, to be able to see those actors like rock star Maggie Smith or Shirley MacLaine or Miss Dockery, right? To see the costumes that they wore is always kind of a thrill. You will see in the exhibition costumes from downstairs and upstairs. And then you will see one costume we were able to get from the film that was just released in December of 19, worn by the Queen. So There's a little for everything, everyone, and I must admit, as many men enjoy coming to see the costumes as women, because I think everybody was glued to their television set on PBS every week when Downton Abbey was shown. There are four spaces at the Chateau that are very safe for visitors, especially if you're coming with a friend who you're comfortable social distancing. It's quite a large building, but we have the plaza out front where you can bring your own lunch and enjoy an afternoon together. We have the Ruelle, which is the alley of the Chateau, which is a very large urban sort of garden now, which is lovely. We have the salon, which is an indoor area, and then we have the theater where the exhibition is. So it's quite safe. And then of course we're practicing all safe precautionary social distancing, but there's plenty of room to be safe. And then we also have our liquor license now at the Chateau, so you can enjoy a glass of bubbles or a glass of wine or a beer as well, which people have been really anxiously awaiting for.
For more information about this story and other Our Town features, connect with us on Facebook, Twitter at KSMQ hashtag Our Town, or ksmq.org/ourtown. I'm being selfish, don't know where my head is. Don't got the answers to all of your questions.
This ain't no catch 22. Losing my senses, don't know what. The Med City Marathon is going virtual this year. Since 1996, Med City Marathon has been providing a high-quality, fun, and energetic marathon in Rochester. But for the 25th anniversary, runners are asked to participate while staying safe and practicing social distancing. Start your race anywhere, any place, and any time. Med City Marathon asks that you record your race and submit them before September 30th. The virtual Med City Marathon is being presented by Active PT 2.0, and registration is open until Friday, September 4th. More information is available on the Med City Marathon website at medcitymarathon.com. And the City of Rochester is looking for artists whose livelihoods have been affected by COVID-19. In collaboration with our neighbors, Rochester is investing in the creation of neighborhood-based art, including permanent outdoor painted murals throughout Rochester neighborhoods in the fall of 2020. Grant amounts will be provided based on the square footage of the mural, with compensation ranging from $1,500 to $4,000. Additional dollars will be provided for supplies. Murals should be painted in places easily seen by the public, throughout the neighborhoods, and maybe in public spaces, at schools, and at businesses. Any private properties must have owner's written approval prior to grant approval. Interested artists are asked to complete an application by September 10th, 2020. Selected applicants will be notified by September 16th, 2020, and grant applications can be found on the Our Neighbors website at ourneighbors.org. And the debate between the Beatles and the Rolling Stones has been going on ever since they first crossed paths on the charts 54 years ago. The argument at the time, and one that still persists, was that the Beatles were a pop group and the Stones were a rock band. The boys next door versus the bad boys of rock. So who's better? These two legendary bands will engage in an onstage throwdown, a musical showdown, if you will. Beatles tribute band Abbey Road and Stones tribute band Satisfaction, the International Rolling Stones Show, will battle it out on the stage at the Mayo Civic Center, Saturday, September 19th. Showtimes are at 5 p.m. and 8 p.m. Tickets are on sale now at Ticketmaster.com. And coming up next, we head to the Rochester Arts Center to visit with Shahnoor Shafqat and explore her newest exhibit, Innocent Predators, on this week's Walkabout segment.
Hi, I'm Shahnoor Shafqat, and I'm going to be talking about my work here at Rochester Arts Center. It's a series called Innocent Predators. You know, it's about how I perceive my children. My characters here in my different paintings are more monster-looking. Like, it's about explaining an experience of a mother and how, you know, she felt difficulty and raising her kids in different times. It's about the need of a child is so overwhelming for a mother that she can't really express, you know. It's like your kids, they want you all the time and there's hardly any break. I find my kids really interesting sometimes, you know. I feel that they are like tiny monsters who are trying to consume my energy and my time and everything. You know, sometimes they look so innocent. That's why I've named it Innocent Predators, because I feel they're predators who are trying to consume everything you have and kind of attack you. But then they're so innocent and cute, you know. So that's why I'm suggesting like those fangs and pointed ears and scary eyes and rough skin textures. And on the same time, you know, they have still those innocent, cute bodies of kids and, you know, some angelic features. Many, many mothers were really shocked to see the idea of having them as monsters, but then many felt that it was just really funny. You know, like, I mean, it's also a kind of, it's an idea of bringing a little joy to all those mothers too, like showing empathy to them.
With the trees on the beach singing, nothing gonna hold me back. Words, I'ma spend it all.
In the summer of 2018, Rochester became the first city in the United States to become an intercultural city. Since that time, work has been focused on completing an index question set that would provide the city with the data on its current state as it pertains to issues of diversity, equity, and inclusion. The index has been completed, and here to tell us all about the findings and what comes next is Dee Sabol, Executive Director of the Diversity Council. Welcome to our town.
Hi, Nicole. Thank you. Really pleased to be here.
Well, this is super exciting. I know this has been many years in the making, and certainly the report was highly anticipated. Can you tell us a little bit about what the report contains and what was the primary goal of the index?
Okay. So, you know, Intercultural Cities Initiative was started by the Council of Europe, and we are the first city in the U.S. to participate, the third in North America. And the idea behind this is, how can we look at ourselves and benchmark and lay out a benchmark of where we are on these different issues related to interculturalism. Interculturalism being a space where everyone participates in both the design and the benefit from public policy and social contract kinds of things. So the index really is to help us understand, where are we? How do we understand ourselves? And to place us in comparison with cities all over the globe who are engaged in this initiative. But really, it's measuring us against ourselves over time. That's the most important aspect.
For sure. Those cities, I know we've been following this on our town for quite a while. Can you just name some of the other cities that Rochester is being benchmarked against?
So they really range in size and scope from Paris to Tokyo to very small towns in Europe and in Asia. Lots of capital cities are involved. And then we have Mexico City and Toronto in North America. Those are the only other two. And we're right there in with all of them. There are cities our size. And as we look at, borrowing expertise, looking at things that are working elsewhere, we will look at cities that have similar demographics to ours, are they healthcare based, right, as a driver of their economy? Are they similar in size? Do they have similar levels of diversification of population and those kinds of things?
Yeah, that's fantastic.
So lots of different cities.
Yeah, because I was just thinking, I was like, how would we compare to Mexico City? It's a complete,
right?
Sure, but that's
we
great.
We couldn't even fit in a pocket of Mexico City.
Of course
City,
not,
right?
Yeah, just one little, neighborhood.
Right.
What were some of the key indicators that the index looked at?
You know, I think the ones that are, it's kind of got this policy focus, right? How are we doing in these areas in terms of policy? So things that are critically important to us right now, like public space, the development of public space. You know, we are thinking and redesigning public spaces. How are we doing that? That resonated with me because we had, tried a new practice in the development of Discovery Walk, which is a new public space coming online. How are we thinking differently? What do our policies bring to that? Education, hugely important to us. Neighborhoods, of course, economic things. And then the other parts of culture and life that either resonate with people or don't, and allow people to feel that they belong and are included in community or are not.
So I guess my question really is, how did we do? What were some of the key recommendations that really stuck out to you?
You know, I think the exciting part for me in reading and looking at the responses, and I really want people to go into this with their own, you know, experience and lens and take a look at it. But I will say that it was exciting to me to hear from our, you know, our stakeholders within the city of Rochester, capital C city of Rochester, that they see some low-hanging fruit for policy change. And then we just need to be certain, right, that we don't just have the same people from the same institutions looking at the policies and changing them, but that we truly create processes where people from all over our community participate in the redesign of policy. So I don't want to put in people's minds where I think we're doing bad or good. And really the index isn't meant to do that. It's meant to show where we're ahead of the curve and where we're a little behind the curve and where those opportunities are going to be for us to move forward in little steps and big steps. And if you think about this coinciding with Destination Medical Center, right? And this idea that we want to become America's city for health, and what does that mean to us in terms of equity, health equity, and other kinds of equity. So, you know, my excitement is that people have already begun to comment. We heard, you know, right away from Lori Carroll, Chancellor of UMR, who said, great, you know, what you found in the index related to education is great, but we must discuss the continuum of education, including all of the higher ed, you know, things going on and opportunities going on in our community and resources that we have, and how those, especially policies for blending and creating that continuum, how are we doing that work? So that's been the excitement for me, to see people stepping right in, to watch just, you know, conversations pop up on Facebook, where people are like, oh, okay, you know, obviously we haven't been indexed correctly, right? And then it's like, okay, let's hold that thought and think about, really, are we not, does the index as it currently stands not really reflect where we are? Because there is room for that. Sure. And then if we don't like where we fall, how do we change that? How do we move past that and progress together collaboratively?
So there's a flexibility there with that.
Absolutely.
That's just meant to inform, certainly, and guide our process. You mentioned the city of Rochester, sort of with the big C, and some low-hanging fruit. Do you see some low-hanging fruit already within this index that you think we can be addressing now?
Yeah, absolutely. And I will say that, you know, when I think, Nicole, about all of the collaborative work that's been going on lately, you know, mm-hmm. So you have the COVID-19 cross-sector response team, and that through their work, they started to look at some of these same issues differently. And food response is one. And they were like, okay, outside of the pandemic, we could be doing things a lot better in terms of food response and our cultural awareness in our food response, right? So I do see that efforts like that, the America's City for Health team, Cradle to Career, the nonprofit consortium, the work going on at the county, especially through, you know, the community health improvement plan, all of those are going to provide really fertile ground for some quick policy changes. You know, they already have community engagement at the heart of the work that they're doing, already have, you know, found ways to connect with community, and we need to expand those things. But I see those being spaces where we're going to be able to say, wow, I think there's something we can do right away.
You know, before we got on here, we were talking a little bit just about, I mean, we're sort of in this moment of renewed struggle for racial and social justice. And, you know, the ICI project certainly predates all of this, but it comes out of this as well. And as we're finishing up here, I'd love to hear your thoughts about what do you hope that the ICI will achieve in terms of addressing so many of the concerns that have kind of come up from all of this in our city?
You know, it absolutely at its heart is about equity. You know, creating a community that acknowledges first where its inequities lie, and then actively convenes and plans and implements to correct those inequities. And, you know, the racial tension, the concern around so many of our systems, our public safety systems, our education system, you know, other places. We have to be having these conversations. We have to be doing it now. That sense of urgency has never been greater. And we can utilize this particular tool, this initiative, to work smarter, right? To borrow and blend experiences from other communities, and to really develop a framework, you know, going forward where we do this kind of work this way from now on. So, you know, that is my hope. Ultimately, you know, I say this about all of the initiatives going on right now, you know, cradle to career can't fail. It can't. We have to address our education, you know, equity issues. And this is the same thing. You know, we need to take advantage of this opportunity and use these tools, use the expertise to really change who we are as a community. And if we do, we are going to compete economically way better than our peers. We are going to have the strength to compete in an economic and social development sense that our peers are going to be envious of.
Well, thank you so much, Dee. Thank you for all your work. And we will be sure to keep tabs on further developments. Thanks a lot for joining us.
Thanks.
And thank you all for joining us here on Our Town. Please be well and stay safe. And we will see you next week for Our Town, the show about Rochester.